Championship on ESPN+. We welcome you into Highland Arena for some postseason gymnastics as we are getting ready for the MIC Gymnastics Championship here at Highland Arena in St. Charles, Missouri. Thank you for joining us here this afternoon on ESPN+. Jacob Sonic alongside Caleb Deckard. And Caleb, this is going to be an incredible day of gymnastics. This is going to be probably the tightest conference championship out of every single one in the nation. Five great teams, all of them, all in contention for this championship. I mean, what are you excited for today?
I'm just excited. There's going to be so many great athletes on the floor tonight. This, again, you said this is such a tight conference. All the teams are so, so close. They've been so tight this whole season. And it's really going to come down to who stays on the event, who can stick their landing, and who can get the highest score, who can do the best on the day. It's really, it has to do with what happens today. The rest of the season kind of goes out the window.
All five teams have traveled well, and not just with the team, they have brought an incredible crowd with them as well. Illinois State, the defending champions of the MIC here. Centenary, the ladies. Southeast Missouri State as well. Lindenwood, who at one point won seven straight MIC championships, one of those being a tie with the former University of Illinois Chicago. That was all the way back in 2019, excuse me. Texas Women's, though, they also have a championship. That one back in 2022. So not that long ago after they snapped Lindenwood's streak, the Pioneers. And there's a lot of stories coming into tonight and between all of these teams. Centenary, Division III school, they have had some success, some ups and downs. They have only one score over 190 so far this season, but have put on some incredible performances. They had a performance up here in Highland Arena all the way back February 4th, finished that one with a 187.95. SEMO themselves, 7-17-1 coming into this afternoon. They've seen Lindenwood a couple of times, or just one. Actually, the most they've seen is Missouri. Out of all of the teams, they have seen the University of Missouri the most. As you see the Redbirds taking the floor, the defending champions, they are coming into this afternoon 15-11. 26 total performances. They have been incredible. Last time against Lindenwood, which was back here at Highland Arena, they lost them by just a mere margin, less than a full point, 196.075 to 195.25. Took down Southeast Missouri twice. Actually make that, or 2-1 against Southeast Missouri as they dropped them once in Lincoln, Nebraska when they took on Nebraska, North Carolina. Also have split with Lindenwood 1-1 this season as well. But this has been a conference that has seen so many different storylines. It's been a very high-scoring conference in comparison to what people certainly expected from a lot of these teams, as they might not be an LSU or Mizzou, but they have seen their fair share of competition. And you see Southeast Missouri State now taking the floor. This is just the second time Lindenwood has hosted the MIC Championships. Last time they hosted, 2018, where the Lions took home the championship. A 195-225 was the winning score for the Lions all the way back in 2018. Lions' last championship was in 2021. Of course, Illinois State is the reigning champs, the second highest score in championship day history. Illinois State finished last year with a 196.375 with a winning score. The highest in championship history goes all the way back to 2003, where Illinois Chicago won it with a total of 196.575. Down in Shreveport, Louisiana, home of Centenary College.
And we've seen so many records broken this season, both Lindenwood and SEMO have gotten a program record team score both in the 197s, the first ever 197 in both of their school's histories. Several other records have been broken, like Lindenwood has gotten a program record on bars with 49.25 and the solo program record from Hannah Moon, a 9925. SEMO also got at that meet with the 197, the Tennessee Classic, also broke the fault and uneven bars program records. We've also seen some all-around records. Lydia Webb now holds their all-around highest score, actually beat out their head coach who had the record before. And of course, the only 10 of the entire conference this season from Lindsay Ockler. Unfortunately, we won't see her compete tonight, but she did get a 10 at that Tennessee Classic meet earlier this year. Also, Texas women's has had a fabulous season as well with a program record on floor, 49.375, and several program record-breaking routines from Daisy Woodring, Caitlin Hoyland, and Sophie Hernandez. We'll see them later today, and they will absolutely challenge for individual titles.
Coming on the floor now, the home team, Lindenwood Lions, and you can just feel the floor shake as just the center section here at Highland Arena erupted. That was enough to send this entire arena into a shake. And they have had themselves an incredible season. They have seen the likes of Illinois, Mizzou, Northern Illinois, former MIC team. They've seen Florida, Denver, Air Force, Nebraska. They have seen a fair share of competition. They are looking to bring it into this afternoon with a lot of fire as well.
And there's a lot of competition on this floor tonight. It's going to be hard to take the title, but I know they really want to. They were just shy of getting the championship last year, and I know that they're definitely going to want to get it here at home. And tonight we'll see three all-arounders in Nia Krause, Hannah Applegate, and Jaylee Jones.
As you mentioned, Lindenwood getting that program record for score high, 197.075, as they took the Tennessee Collegiate Classic over Fisk University in Northern Illinois. And they have one of the deepest rosters in the country, or in the conference, I should say. They have put up some incredible scores. Very rarely do you see five gymnasts and out of, you know, an 8.5 in just one of them. We've seen some incredible score lines from the Lindenwood side, and we've seen some incredible scores from the entire field. We'll lay out very quickly for our nation's anthem. Thank you once again for joining us here for the MIC Championships here on ESPN Plus as we take a look at our NSQ National Score Qualifiers for tonight. And Caleb, take us through it.
So the NQS, the National Qualifying Score, it's what's used for the latter half of the season to get the rankings through everyone in the nation, and then they use those rankings to see what teams and what individuals qualify to the regional championships. here tonight. We have some people to follow, as tonight's performance could make or break whether or not they qualify to the regional championships. The big story, a name you'll hear throughout the entire night, Angelica Labatt. She's such a fabulous gymnast. She actually won the Athlete of the Year award for the fourth time in the row for the MICs. And you see these scores next to these athletes' names are the scores that they want to drop as part of their NQS. The NQS is the top six scores with the highest score dropped. It's an average, and you want to maximize that score so you can ensure you qualify to regionals. And to beat this number that's next to each athlete's name will increase their number and increase their chances of making it to those regionals.
Well, you see how tight and how difficult it's going to be to try and beat those scores, but they'll try tonight. But the biggest thing thereafter is a conference championship. We'll take a quick break. We come back, we will continue to get you ready and get underway at the MIC Conference Championships here at Adelaide Arena here on ESPN+. Welcome back into Highland Arena as we are in our warm-up period, getting ready for this championship Saturday. All roads have led to Highland Arena for this afternoon as these five teams are trying to earn that conference crown and dethrone Illinois State. Illinois State trying to defend. So we take a look at our scoring breakdown. Caleb, what are we looking at here?
So obviously, you want to get as close to the 10.0 as possible. It's the perfect score, but any score in the 9.9s is exactly what this team would need and they would obviously want. But really, you want to see a good or close to acceptable score in the 9.7s or 9.8s. Anything below a 9.7, it starts to get a little bit scary. That's the score that you want to drop. Of the six routines, you want to drop the lowest number. And if that can be a 9.7, then the rest of the lineup has done their job. You see right there, the gymnast took a step on that dismount landing. Whenever you land elements on the floor or you land your dismount on the bars in the beam, you want to stick the landing, meaning you land and do not move, and you will get no deduction, just like right there. You see she brought her heels together, and that would incur no deduction. A large step can be upwards of 2/10, and then obviously if you fall, it's no good, and that would be a half-point deduction. A breakdown of how these gymnasts can score high. To reach that 10, you have to have a 10.0 start value, meaning you have to reach these certain requirements. On each event, you have to have a combination pass, for example, on floor, or a leap series on beam, or release moves on bars. We'll get more into that as we see each of the routines, but it's imperative that all of these athletes can reach that 10.0 to maximize their scoring potential.
We'll take a look at our points emphasis. And obviously, the biggest thing with those scoring is each routine, they only take the top five, and you need all five of those to be pretty high. As we take a look at our points emphasis, and Caleb, you know, we have so many different routines and events. What's going to be the biggest thing starting off here with the vault?
Vault, what's going to be really big is the start value. The majority of these athletes will have a 9.95 start value, meaning they'll already start a little bit behind, meaning that's the highest number that they can achieve, not a 10. But obviously you want to execute your vault as nice as you can with straight legs and legs together and toes pointed. And of course, stick the landing. That's what all these athletes are looking to do. They've been working towards it the whole season and they wanted to put it together at this big meet.
And on the bars.
What's really most important is out of the kip pass handstands, you want to maintain that completely vertical position. And obviously, to get your difficulty up to a 10, you have to have release moves. You'll see same bar release moves or transitions from the high bar to the low bar. And of course, stick the dismount. We'll hear about stick the whole day. Sticks are really what's going to make or break this championship.
And on the beam.
The balance beam, you have to have connections of both dance elements and acro elements. And of course, it's a balance beam. You've got to stay on and you've got to keep your balance.
And our last one, the floor.
The floor, you have to put together a difficult routine with nice tumbling and, of course, presentation to the music. And you have to have nice landings. You can take a lunge out of your landing, but you want to keep the routine as presented as nicely as possible.
Well, we are getting closer and closer. Just about every team ready to go as we take a look at our rotation one here. Lindenwood on the vault. Texas Women on the bars. Illinois State on the beam and Southeast Missouri State on the floor.
Got Lainey Hunt starting off for Texas Women's on the bars. Also Kaylin Hamilton on the floor. And this is Hannah Applegate in the leadoff for Lindenwood on vault. We'll see here in the all-around today.
Hannah Applegate has been Lindenwood's arguably their best gymnast of the year.
Really, really strong landing near the full to Stingerchenko. Again, this is a 9.95 start value, but she really maximized this vault and minimized the deductions.
So a good start for the Lions, and you can just hear how excited every team is for each and every one of their teammates, and I think that's the best part about gymnastics is the camaraderie and the teamwork as well. And I said this before, I love on the floor routines how just about every single gymnast knows every floor routine for each of their teammates, and that I think is incredible.
Here we've got Maya Robinson in the leadoff for Illinois State. This is probably the most important role of the entire meet, this leadoff on beam, and starting on beam can be so nerve-wracking. It's the event where nerves can have the biggest effect on you, so getting this strong start right there. Gorgeous dismount. That's exactly what this team was looking for. She completely did her job for the Redbirds.
So each team getting good starts. Now Jaylee Jones will step up for the Lions at the vault position.
And she's been very solid in this number two spot. That's what's been consistent with their vault lineup strategy is that she's number two. They've changed around the leadoff and the rest of the lineup. I think they really trust Applegate and Jones as their all-arounders. They're really big rocks for this team, and I think they really trust them to start the team off well on vault.
So still awaiting the start. Jordan Napolitano out on the floor for SEMO as they are about to get underway. As over on the bars, Cammy Zerlengo. Texas Women's a Division II team, but that is probably the best part about college gymnastics. You can have gymnasts compete from Division I all the way down to the NAI level at the same, pretty much the same level, essentially. And that is an amazing part of this sport as well. Centenary themselves, who still, they will be up next. They'll be taken up on the uneven bars in the next rotation, their first look of the day.
That was a fabulous routine from Kimmy Zarlingo. Such great execution. Here's Jaylee Jones. Quite a large step backward. And unfortunately, a fall on the left of your screen for Jordan. That 2.5 punch front, 2.5s are something this team takes pride in. They all do them, most of them do them, and it's a skill that's pretty rare as it's very difficult, especially to punch out of that into the front tuck. But that will incur a half-point deduction. Definitely going to be the score that they want to drop.
As you were saying before, Centenary themselves, they are a Division III college out of Shreveport, Louisiana. Texas Women's Division II out of Denton, Texas, just north of Dallas. We see our first scores coming in. Hannah Applegate gifted a 9.75 on the vault. And for SEMO, Kaylin Hamilton with a 9.7, so good starts for both the Redhawks and the Lions for the scores we have so far.
I believe we'll have the first beam score come in. There was a bit of a judges conference over on the beam. A little nerve-wracking for the very first routine that happens, but hopefully the judges can get that sorted out and the other athletes can have more smoother routines. Typically when that happens, there's some sort of discrepancy or there's some sort of start value issue. It typically happens when a large mistake is in the routine, but she started off quite nicely, so I would love to know what they were chatting about.
Joy Zeigenfelder up on the beam as over on the bars, Carolyn Bounds, with an impressive routine so far.
And she's got impeccable line, such perfect toe point. Oh, no, and could not hold on to that landing, that double tuck. That will be, like I said, a half point deduction for the fall.
That is a tough break. That's Reese Beekle on the vault for the Lions. See that, really a little bit of a small hop, but hopefully not too detrimental. That was another great routine, this one coming from Reese Beekle.
Really strong start for the Lions. A 9-7 comes in for Jaylee Jones's vault.
So 19-4-5 so far for the Lions, team total. Now we might see the scores up right now, but I don't think the coaches or the athletes are doing the difficult math in their heads while also trying to focus on their competitions. So we'll see the great reactions when they announce our score lines, champions, and separate awards as well later on after the rotations are through. That is also the fun of this sport, is you really don't know if you've won until the total end.
We just saw Joyce Eigenfelder there. She took the MIC beam title last year. Unfortunately, don't think it'll happen again as she had a fall. This is Sydney Crouch, the number three spot for SEMO. And it is crunch time for them because there is a fall in the lineup. They have to drop that if they want to stay in contention. Pretty nice Rudy to punch stag jump to get that connection bonus there. See that 9.075 comes in. That's definitely not a score you want in your team total.
So they will look to drop that number two spot. Typically, the two most important routines are the first and your anchor spot in that final position, unless you can really drop one of those scores before you even hit that final spot. But of course, you still need all six to compete well. So we'll keep an eye on how Madison Green does, but for right now, Sydney Crouch just keeping it inside the line side.
Really difficult final pass there. 1.5 front full, gets 3/10 of bonus. Really nice reset routine for them. Get the rest of that lineup back on track. The floor is a really strong event for SEMO, and I'm sure they have faith in the last three gymnasts in their lineup to turn around this rotation. See on the left of your screen, Allie Berkeley salutes. We'll get another one of those Yurchenko fulls. She's a fabulous vaulter. She's a vault specialist. Gets so much height. And a stuck landing. Just a little off to the left, but that was such a fabulous vault. She's so dynamic, and it's just such a fabulous gymnast. I'm so glad we see her in the vault lineup. Aaliyah Gilmore on bars. Very unique stalder into her dismount and sticks the landing. That's what I love so much about this conference is there's so much uniqueness to it. Everyone has their own special routines with their own unique moves. It's so special.
Most recent score for the Lions as Reese Beekle has gotten herself a 9.825. And we get some scores from Texas women's on the bars as well. A 9.725 for Cami Zerlengo and a 9.225 for Carolyn Bounds. And Lainey Hunt herself also getting a 9.675.
Really strong lead combo there for Leah Davis. This has been a really, really solid routine. Nice form and very minimal wobbles.
Illinois stateside, Maya Robinson with a 9.875, an impressive start on the beam. But as you see, Joy Ziegenfelder with that 9.175, they'll try and drop that one after she had that tough fall.
As Davis sets up for her dismount, nice cartwheel, 1.5 stark landing. Such a fabulous, again, one of those reset routines for the lineup. But really, really gorgeous there. Would not mind a higher score than Robinson there. Definitely could see something in the 9.9s there. Just before they switched to the vault cam on the left, you might have saw a judges conference over on the floor. Not entirely sure what that would have been about. Maybe one of her leaps or jumps didn't quite hit the prescribed position. But that's the second judges conference of the meet so far, and we're only halfway through rotation one, a little bit wary. However, the judges just want to make sure that they evaluate the routines fairly and consistently. That's their most important job.
As we await the green flags. And now Taylor Engel will step up on the floor. Kathy ready to go. It's Allie Berkey's score. Comes in a 9.775. So are you looking to drop Jaylee Jones's score, who still put up a good 9.7? Which really, if you're able to drop a 9.7, I'd be happy with that.
2.5 punch front for Engel. That's the pass that Napolitano fell on. So really nice that she could get that there. She was gymnast of the week for the MIC last week, getting a huge all-around number. Definitely in that all-around race today. And Ali Lau, the newcomer of the year, the MIC over on beam, misses the event that she specializes in. Combo pass for Engel. Layout Rudy. And a small wobble on the left for Lau. Again, both of these teams have a fall now, so it is very important that they can stay together. Stuck gainer full for Lau. And another hit in the books for both Illinois State and SEMO. Caitlin Hoyland on the right. She holds the program record on bars for Texas women's. Gorgeous toe point, very difficult Pike Yeager. And Trinity Caffey's off. And just the hop backwards. I saw her stuck one perfectly in the warm-up, but that was still a great vault. Full giant into the double tuck. Such a gorgeous routine. She's absolutely someone that could take this MIC bars title, and with that routine, I would not be shocked if she did.
Well, another person to keep an eye on coming up next for the Lions, Gayla Griswold. She holds a season high on the vault this season for the Lions, and it is an impressive 9.95.
And she too has the program record for Lindenwood of a 9.975. She got that last year. Definitely a lot of potential championship moments in this rotation. another 9.875 comes in for Davis, the second one for the Redbirds. Lydia Webb steps out on the floor. They really have a 1-2-3 punch on floor for SEMO. Such unique choreography. I love this routine. Gorgeous 2.5 twist, wraps that around beautifully.
So Lydia Webb, who is up, she has the season high for Southeast Missouri on the floor with a 9.925.
And this is an important routine for Madison Kipp. She was on the NQ West list. Small wobble there, but covers it up actually quite nicely. I wouldn't be shocked if she only gets a half 10 deduction for that wobble. The score that she's looking to drop is a 9.825. Really, that can only be the mistake she makes if she wants to reach that number or higher. Small scoop back on that switch half. Cleanly through the full turn as on the left. This is Webb's dismount. 1.5 front layout. A little problem with the punch there, but saves it nicely. Here's Kipp's dismount. 1.5 just to hop in place. Not sure if that will reach the 9.825 to drop that for her NQS, but it was still a strong hit for the Redbirds. She's just on the cusp of making it to the regionals. I believe she was tied for the last spot. So hopefully she can raise that number a little bit. And this is Brooke Ferrari on the right of your screen in the anchor spot, as well as the anchor for Lindenwood on the left, Gigi Griswold.
Gayla Griswold does hold that season high on the vault. Though no perfect 10s yet on that vault. Lions still looking for their first perfect 10 of the season in any category.
Ooh, and just the full for Gigi. Was expecting her to do a 1.5. She's been out of the vault lineup for a lot of the season, so I'm sure she's just playing it safe. And a nice discount for Brooke Ferrari. She has one of the most unique routines in this meet with that straddle back transition move, very rare. Not entirely sure if that full twist from Gigi was intended. Like I said, she hasn't been competing vault consistently in March, so that could just be a decision they made today.
We'll see those scores coming in for Texas women's. Kaylin Hoyland, still waiting that score. She has a season high of a 9.95 on the bar. And right behind her, Ferrari with a 9.925. So we'll see as Hoyland has a 9.750. So not bad. We'll see what Ferrari has scored as well.
Perfectly stuck pass for Madison Green in the anchor spot. She's such an interesting technique on her front layout. She has a more hollow position. You usually see a more arch position, especially in those front whip type elements. And Angelica Labatt has mounted the beam.
You see the scores coming in now. Lindenwood with that 48.850, awaiting the score from Gayla Griswold. See if that boosts it up at all. See if she can drop the score of Jayla Jones.
Strong series there for Angelica. This is very important for her all-around performance today.
And GG. Gayla Griswold coming in with a 9.825, so the score coming up not too much higher, but enough. 48.975 for the Lions, and that's what they will finish up on the vault. Illinois State on the beam as they are getting towards the end with Angelica Labatt.
Perfectly stuck dismount.
Illinois State sitting at a 48.525. Will awaiting that one score. They certainly drop Joy Ziegenfelder's score with that impressive routine. Southeast Missouri awaiting Green's score and now sitting at that 47.925. And Texas women's with the 48.125, their highest. Brooke Ferrari with a 9.775, total 48.675 as that one just comes across our screen. Well, we are wrapping up rotation one here. We'll take a quick break. We come back. Rotation number two as a 9.95 comes across. Why don't we take a quick break, though? Give yourself a breather. Grab some popcorn. Do whatever you need to do. We'll get ready as well. This is the MIC Championships on ESPN+. Welcome back to the MIC Conference Championships as we just saw a personal best on the beam for the Illinois State Redbird, that being Angelica Labatt, a 9.925 career high. And could not have come at a better time as they jump on top of the five teams, 49.275, as we will now see Centenary in for their first time this afternoon as we take a look at some of the highlights from that first rotation as these teams warm up. This was the opening routine for Illinois State. And it has been some impressive gymnastics so far. There's been a couple of tough falls, but overall there have been some very impressive performances.
The team has yet to count a fall. However, Illinois State has set themselves up very nicely with this 49.275.
The highest scores from each one. On the vault, both Reese Beekel and Gayla Griswold got 9.825s. On the bars for Texas women's, Brooke Ferrari with a 9.775. On the beam, of course, Labatt with a 9.925, a personal best on the beam. And on the floor, Madison Green with a 9.85 for Southeast Missouri State. And of course, each routine is scored a little bit differently, so the scores are gonna be different. And that's why after rotation number one, it's still far, and I mean far from over. It is anybody's match, and it is gonna just be more and more incredible as we go on. And after that first rotation, Caleb, I mean, what was the biggest surprise to you?
Honestly, I think Illinois State doing so strong on beam, it's been an event that has caused a bit of an issue for them, that and bars. So for them to start off and so strongly on a weaker event is setting them up very nicely to take this title and then go over to floor, which is by and large their best event.
Beam is just around, they're tied for second best, but it is one of their tougher categories and they move on. Well, we'll head over to another quick break. We come back, rotation number two. This is the MIC Championships on ESPN+. Rotation number two about to get underway here at the MIC Championships here in St. Charles, Missouri, inside of Highland Arena, home of the Lindenwood Lions. Jacob Sonic alongside Caleb Deckard. If you're just joining us, Illinois State taking the lead right now after getting a 49.275 on the beam. Over on the beam now is Texas Women's, the Pioneers, and kicking us off, Emily Six. Over on the bars, Centenary College getting their first action of the afternoon, Isabel Plaza. starting off for the ladies.
Very unique routine construction for Plaza. Oh, unfortunately, cannot get over on that giant there. I actually imagine she was supposed to do her dismount there and just did not feel comfortable.
Plaza's season high coming into this afternoon is a 9.4 flat. On the beam side with Emily Six. She has gotten not up to a 9 yet this season, but still an impressive 9.825.
Nice first pass for Sarah Wabi. I was talking to the Illinois State coaching staff, and their floor team is so amazing that they said that any of them could take the title on floor. Unfortunately, a fall on the dismount for Isabel Plaza. Really unfortunate. Off the top of the routine, she did that straight front hacked with the half turn to catch. Very, very interesting. Unfortunately, could not put together the whole routine today.
Lindenwood right now on their break, so they will get some time to rest up, but certainly would want to be, I'd want to be the team that would probably get a rest either in that third or probably the third rotation, honestly, I would say, or even the fourth rotation. You get three events in, take a break, do that final event, fully energized and ready to go when it really matters. But, you know what, they're doing well. Second place right now, a whopping 0.3 behind Illinois State after the first rotation.
Gorgeous Yurchenko half, a much rarer vault. With that blind landing, you cannot see the ground before your feet have already touched the ground. Starts out of a 9.95.
Engel tied with the team high with Green and Webb over on the beam, or excuse me, second on the beam vault. Whoa, I'm getting my numbers all mixed up. I apologize. Taylor Engel she gets a 9.75 on the vault. Her season high, 9.85. Madison Green holds the season high for the Redhawks. She's in that anchor position. Surprise, surprise. She has a season high of 9.875.
Sophie Hernandez in the number two spot on beam for the Pioneers. Gorgeous back handspring layout step out there. Every gymnast must show a combination of two acrobatic elements. Difficult switch to switch half to the beat jump with lots and lots of bonus. That's how she starts from a 10-0. There's her dismount, the backhand spring into the 1.5 and just a hop forward.
See what that does. She's trying to break her season high. 9.825. There's certainly some good depth in terms of the beam for this Texas women's side, but that hasn't been their best event this season, but still some impressive scores.
Nice first pass for Leah Davis there. This is Jordan Napolitano on vault. Nice comeback here with a strong vault. She did she sat down her first pass over on floor. Fong Yurchenko tough bullets out of a 9.9.
First score coming across for Illinois State, Sarah Wabi with a 9.825 on the floor. Taylor Engel still the lone vault score out yet at a 9.75 on the vault. On the beam, Emily Six, that 9.750. Still awaiting any score for Centenary yet.
A little short on that final pass for Leah Davis. That this might be a bit of a lower score. I think both of her combination passes, she had a hop backwards. Whenever you land forwards, you want to take your step forwards, your lunge, to show that you have enough rotation completed in that flip. Daisy Wood, ring over on beam, the athlete of the year and women of the year for MIC. Those awards were given out last night at their banquet.
Still awaiting a green flag on the bars. And now we are underway. Olivia Williams.
Nice clear hip to bail. Perfect handstand position there. Coming after that pretty rough routine from Plaza, they need a strong reset. Huge full twisting double back. Just a step forward, but that was a gorgeous bar routine. Unfortunately, she only has one release move, so she won't start from the 10, but that was a really strong routine nonetheless. And a nice dismount for, I believe that was Daisy Woodring.
Still awaiting that first score for Centenary on the beam.
Is Janelle Lopez, a full twist vault. Just a small hop backwards and a little low on the landing with that pike. You want to keep your hips open in the air so you can prepare for the the landing much better. Alana Laster, the reigning MIC all-around champion, although today we'll only see her in floor and vault.
See Ailey Kuhn getting that 9.750, and Napolitano with a 9.7 flat over on the vault. Nothing over 9.8. We'll try and still boost it up.
A little off on the jump series there. I saw her do it much better in warm-ups, unfortunately, but still really strong. She has so much amplitude in all of her elements. Takes everything to its highest degree.
You get her first score across for Centenary, Isabel Plaza. 7.875 with those two falls.
Huge layup step out of that, Rudy. Yeah, definitely going to be the score that the Centenary ladies went to drop. Steely King over on the beam as Laster finishes. She's another one of those athletes who's in the NQS race.
Julia Davis with that 9.775. I'll try and see if that'll be the score they'll try to drop. As Sol Fernandez, Emily Six, both those 9.750s.
Huge punch front. That's an E element. The most difficult one you can do in college gymnastics. She did have that little wobble, but the judges should be forgiving as that is the most difficult acro element we'll see today.
Daisy Woodring with that 9.825. Still top score for Reese Beekle on the vault, that 9.825.
Perfect 1.5 dismount there. It seemed as soon as she took off from the beam, it almost like you could tell that she was going to get that landing. It was just everything physically was timed out perfectly.
Now on the beam, you got to wonder, is anyone going to be able to beat that 9.925 from Angelica Labatt? It's kind of hard to beat that high of a score in the first rotation. That was an impressive routine and an impressive score to go along with it. It's going to be difficult to top that one. She might be the beam champion this afternoon. We'll wait to see. So a lot of gymnastics to go. Three more rotations, and we're maybe halfway through this one. So still a lot more to go. As you see on the vault, Janelle Lopez at 9.675. That's SEMO's lowest score in the vault so far. Still awaiting some more scores to come across.
Here is Emma Lavelle on bars. Clear hip down to the low bar and back up. That's her second release move. Again, you must show two to start from the 10.0. That's one of the requirements. A little low on the double layout, but just scoots it around, barely has to pike down a little bit, but very, very important that she stayed in her feet there.
I would hope the Centenary coach has a good laundromat to clean all the chalk off that shirt.
Caitlin Donovan beginning her floor routine. She actually took the floor title at the Lindenwood meet where Illinois State competed with a 9.925. Nice double tuck there.
Illinois State, the defending MIC conference champions, they will attempt to top their own score from last year and possibly even set the conference championship record. That one being at that 196.575 mark. Last year, just shy of it by .2. That 196.375, which was certainly enough to crown them champions.
Gorgeous beam descent there, very dynamic for the Pioneers on beam. On the left, this is Madison Green, the anchor spot. Really nice vault there. I thought she was a little close to the mat around the springboard, but had no problem there. Very gorgeous landing.
Her season high leads the team at 9.875. Madison Green, as she wraps up the vault for the Redhawks. And coming over Donovan. And 2.9825s for Illinois State. And that's certainly what you like to see if you are the Redbirds. Redbirds, Redhawks, aren't those kind of the same thing? Certainly a question to ask. I suppose if you say a red bird, that's very, very broad. Where a hawk is more one species, but they can take it up with each other.
For the ladies, this is Roxanne Myers.
This is the fourth for Centenary. There was one long kind of stoppage. Took them a while to get going with just their second routine. Olivia Williams, that score coming across now, 9.150.
Strong routine so far for Roxanne Myers. Just a step forward on the landing.
Seemed like she landed maybe a little lower than she wanted to, a little bit more tucked than I think she probably would have preferred. Emma LaValle coming across, 9.250.
And Caitlin Hoyland on the beam had a huge score last week for them. She's a transfer from Oregon State and has done some fabulous work for the Pioneers this season. Labatt over on the floor, following that huge 9.925 on beam. Brandon Spring double front twist.
Hoyland had a 9.75 on the bars. As she gets a great dismount as she clears out the anchor spot. She's got a 9.9 flat for her season high. We'll see if that was enough to possibly tie it or even break it, and see if maybe she can tie that first score coming from Labatt. As she is on the floor now, competing for that all-around title. See a 9.9 coming from Emma Berklinch. 9.9 routine. We'll see if Hoyland is able to top her own teammate.
Nice routine there for Labatt. She gets so much height on these front tumbling elements. That's really her specialty.
So Madison Green
has taken the lead in the vault category, a 9.85 for Madison Green as she dethrones five Lions all in one scoreline.
Claire Flores mounting the bars. Very interesting to see her mount on top of that mat. Really difficult. Maloney back down with the bail.
Southeast Missouri at a team total 97550 as they got a 48.75.
Winds up double layout dismount. Really strong routine overall. And she should start from a 10, so that can really maximize their scoring potential.
Centenary right now sitting at 35.7, still looking to drop that score from Plaza. A 9.25, 9.425, 7.875, and the 9.15. Let me see if that final score line from Hoyland, if that possibly topped everyone in the category in terms of the beam with a very impressive routine.
And this could be one of the highest scores we see of the day. This is Jay Mack. We'll most likely see her compete in the regionals.
On the floor, 9.95 is her season high.
Huge. Full twisting double pike, the most difficult pass we'll see today. Just that small scoot from her right foot. Again, that 9.95 is a program record for the Redbirds. Sets up for her dismount. This will be a front through to a double pike. Perfect landing.
That one might be contention for a 10.
Absolutely. Such great difficulty and execution as well. It can be so hard to do these E and D tumbling passes well, and she just does them gorgeously. It lands with her chest straight up.
So Labatt gets the fourth 9.825. Four of them for the Redbirds. And that is the definition of consistency. We'll see if Mack breaks that 9.9 mark.
Sophie Schmitz in the anchor spot for the ladies. It's actually her birthday today. Half turn into that Jaeger, nice form. Just can't get up, it'll be an empty swing deduction. Recovers nicely, this giant full into the double tuck, and just a hop forward.
Claire Flores with the most recent score line for the ladies at 9.3.
Huge for Texas women's. Team total on beam of 49.1.
Hoyland with a 9.875. That's actually kind of a surprise to me, but still a great score line for Texas women's. Illinois State now in the lead as we await that final score on the floor for Jay Mack. But we'll take a quick break. We come back, we'll get you a full scoring update and get you ready for our third rotation here at the MIC Championships here on ESPN+. We are through two rotations here at the MIC Gymnastics Championships. Illinois State holding the lead currently as they will have a bye in the next rotation. in this upcoming one, or in the rotation number four, I should say. But take a look at some of the highlights from rotation number two, and we saw a couple of high scores, couple of low scores, and it was certainly an impressive rotation.
Yeah, to see Texas women break 49 and actually match their season high of 49.1 on beam, that's really huge for their chances of taking this team title. A little bit, in my opinion, of an underperformance from the Redbirds on floor. Only one score in the 9-9s, a 9-9 from J-Mac in the anchor spot. That is the highest score on floor of the meet, but I was expecting a little bit more, and I'm sure they were as well. They are on the vault now, another very high-scoring event for them.
Centenary scoring a 46-375. Their highest out of the group was Roxanne Myers with a 9-4-2-5. We'll take one more break. We come back rotation number three here at Highland Arena. We get closer to crowning a champion here at the MIC Conference Championships on ESPN+.
Explore the past.
Welcome back to Highland Arena as we are getting ready for rotation number three. If you're just joining us, Illinois State now in the lead as they try and defend their MIC Conference Championship from last season. Right now they are up at 98.475 as a team. Jacob Sonic alongside Caleb Deckard as we are getting ready for this third rotation. Illinois State will be over on the vault. Texas women's
Is on the floor.
Lindenwood will jump back in. They'll be on the bars, arguably their best, well, definitely their best event of the season so far. And Centenary over on the beam. Centenary started off with their bye rotation, so they'll be on the floor for the rest of the evening. So will Lindenwood as they come off their bye rotation. Southeast Missouri State getting their breather. Illinois State will get theirs next. And you see the rotation there. Illinois State up on the vault. And Illinois State on the vault. It has been all right for them overall, but their highest score, Labatt, 995 for a season high. As starting off will be Madison Kipp.
Really strong pole twisting Yurchenko with that near perfect landing, just that small, minuscule scoot in place. I would not be shocked if that's the highest score so far. And she's just the leadoff in this amazing vault lineup.
That might be, and of course you don't want to jinx it, but that might be her season high. Her season high coming into this afternoon was a 9.775, and I would not be surprised if that beats it.
Almost certainly it should be higher, in my opinion.
That landing was nearly perfect, if not perfect, to a T. I don't know what else she could have done to make that routine more spectacular. Over on the bars, Reese Buechel getting underway. Well, awaiting for a green flag. Just, that's always the difficulty. You're waiting for the judges to be fully prepared, and it happens from time to time. You want to make sure you get scores right and everyone is scoring correctly and together. Hey, you might cool a gymnast down. You get the muscles a little tighter.
Oh, unfortunately, she's off on that first handstand, has to do that half turn to save it. I was just about to say, we haven't seen Reese in the bars lineup a lot this season. So that could be just a little bit of nerves from being out of this lineup.
9.85 is her season high.
Gorgeous double layout, just could not hold on to that landing. It seems she wasn't quite prepared and her knees buckled a bit. On the right of your screen, this has been a great leadoff for Centenary from Riley Molina. And a perfect dismount. That front aerial with a full turn. Very unique technique there.
What a dismount indeed from Riley Molina.
Emily Six leads off on floor. She's a lead off on multiple events. And also Giselle Hurd on the right. Nice. A little late on that half turn. I saw her in warm-ups. It seems she either didn't get the extra half turn in time or she got lost in the air, and I was a bit worried. But really nice to put it together today. She is the 2021 MIC Vault Champion. My sleep series there from Emily Six. See some excitement after the vault landing. Love the angle that we have on vault. We get to see them run back their team and celebrate. Because this is a conference championships, all of the teams, all the athletes that are not competing have to stay in their little corrals, their seats that are in their section that is assigned to them.
Would you say that they would be hurting them?
I don't know. It's not really hurting them to be together and have a good time.
I suppose I didn't see someone chasing after them to put them in there, so I suppose it's not really hurting, but, you know, they're having fun. We're having fun. It's a great afternoon for gymnastics here in St. Charles. Some rich gymnastics history from here.
Cool move there, that pike jump with a half turn to end Emily Six's routine. Another strong leadoff routine from her.
Still awaiting the start of Jaylee Jones's routine. She has been, I suppose, ready to go for a while now, but and she finally gets the green flag.
Sophie Schmitz on beam, the birthday girl, number two. Nice save there from Schmidt and a nice release combo for Jones.
Here comes the dismount.
Almost had the landing, just that small step in place.
Luckily not a step forward or back, was just a little off balance, so should be too bad of a deduction, but still a great routine overall.
Lots of grit from Sophie Schmitz. I've loved her choreography so far. She's very jumpy. You don't typically see that. It can be a little dangerous in the sense that you might fall off, but I love the commitment to it. Backhand spring. Just the full. So you must show a C dismount. Otherwise, you will incur an up-to-level deduction. So she should get that. However, that was a very strong routine and a perfectly executed dismount. Maya Robinson, number three for ISU. Large step backward.
Madeline Ghost over on the floor for the Pioneers.
Really strong double pike there. And we're in for a treat here. Perfect jumps there. Love to see her commit to this choreography too. Really enhances the presentation. Nice final pass there. Really nice, sneaks in that half turn in the Rudy.
See some scores coming across your screen. Kip with a 9.85 and Shelly Hurd with a 9.725.
that 985 puts her in the lead, tied with Madison Green.
And that does break her season high, and there was no doubt about it. I honestly thought that might have been a 9-9. That was an impressive vault. 9-8-5. And you see Beagle with that 9-3-2-5. The Lions' strongest event, the bars. Waiting the score from Jones as Savannah Newsom gets ready. Riley Molina, 9-7-7-5. Not a bad score on the beam as she gets underway. And Emily Six on the floor, the 9-7-5-0. Illinois State continues to grow their lead.
This is a really strong event for Savannah. She got some nice difficulty here. Super high Jaeger, and I could tell she was far on the release. That will mean the Lions are going to count a fall. And it means makes the rest of this routine very important to see if she can hopefully get higher than that 9-3-2-5 to just make the best out of this situation right now. And there still are three routines left in this rotation for the Lions. This is a big moment for this meet, and she knows that that was a big mistake, but all she can do is just finish strong.
The unfortunate side of that as well is because of that fall, this might be a difference maker in who is the conference champion.
She should get support from assistant coach Sam Sherwinski. She's got a big distance here. She's got a focus. Double front. Just that medium-sized step backwards.
Hopefully able to recover a little bit. Get some extra points on top of that. All you can really hope is that it is Beekle's score that ends up being dropped instead of Newsom's, but it does not appear that will be the situation.
Got a big vault. Alana Laster. A little low there, the large step forward. All this drama on bars is happening unbeknownst to the Redbirds. I'm sure they are in their bubble. That's something that the coaching staff was really important to them. They wanted to stay focused on their gymnastics and do what's in their control. Steely King. Floor is a really strong event for her. Nice save there. A little trouble with the punch there on the layout.
She is one of few all-arounders, but not an all-arounder today for Texas women's. She did not compete in bars, but did get a 9.75 on the beam. We'll see if Texas women's does push out a all around, but it does not appear that will be the situation. So no all-arounder for Texas women's this afternoon.
Nice double tuck. Pretty open shape on that. So typically you see people try to limit the axis that they're rotating on, but she was very confident in hers.
Maya Robinson, as you see, picking up that 9.775.
The flag goes up for Naya Kraus. Our first look at her today.
Naya Kraus is one of, along with Applegate, Alliance best gymnasts this season. She has her season high, a 9.9 flat on the bars, tied with Applegate. And another one, keep an eye on. This bottom three is incredible. 9-9 for Kraus and Applegate, and Hannah Moon coming up next is a season high of a 9.925. This next three up, I would certainly keep an eye on for the Lions.
Nice combination there. A little bent arms on that overshoot transition. Perfect handstand there. She really has to go for it. There is no other way. Huge on that dismount. Full twisting double back, completely perfect landing.
Oh my gosh. What a bars routine from Naya Kraus, and that is what the Lions needed. That
was nearly perfection.
Big vault here for J-Mac. And a great landing. Just a small hop backward and a small leg separation in the air.
Another big one, J-Mac, as ISU getting near the bottom of theirs. Their vault lineup. Brooke Murdoch up on the beam for Centenary. On the floor right now, Emma Berklich.
She's right now in second place on beam with a huge 9-9. Hopefully she can carry over that energy to floor. Punch front through to the double tuck. Really nice landing. She's on the side of that mat, but it did not affect her at all.
Berklich, a junior out of Tampa, Florida, transfer from Northern Illinois. And I'd like to know if it's Swedish, Norwegian, Polish, some kind of Scandinavian, that last name.
I believe it's Croatian.
Croatian? I grew up in Minnesota. I got a lot of Scandinavian, but it does appear to be more Middle European. Would love to get an answer on that, but right now it's an incredible performance she's putting on. 2.98s and a 9.75 for Texas women's. They're putting on an impressive showing on the floor.
Very floor, high energy choreography.
Yeah, floor is not their best event, but still putting impressive numbers up. You see on the beam, Centenary, Mila Vitor with that 8-8, so they'll try and make sure that is the one they drop. Newsom, 8-8 for her. So not able to save that routine, and that is going to be a crusher for the Lions.
Big vault here, Angelica Labatt. And a near-perfect landing, just the hop in place, but she knows how to turn it on when she needs to.
Labatt holds a season high, 9.95 on the vault for Illinois State. That one might not be a 9.95, but that will still be a very high score.
Perfect handstand there from Hannah, and just a small hop backward. I saw her do some really perfect dismounts in the warm-ups before the meet began. But again, they just need to salvage the rest of this rotation. And these are the three athletes that you want to have at that latter half of the lineup to make the best of this rotation and make the best of the situation.
Naya Kraus has now taken the lead in the parallel, uneven parallel bars. 9.875 as their score comes across, and that is a big score that the Lions needed. But will it be enough will be the question. Illinois State 48.95 so far on the vault as J-Max scores come across with a 9.85. That is now three gymnasts with 9.85s. Madison Green, J-Mac, and Madison Kipp. See if there's a possible three-way tie for a vault champion, but we still have yet to see Centenary and Texas women on the vault. So that will be the next question.
Stacey Woodring here, a humongous double pike. Again, she's athlete and woman of the year and an incredible floor worker for the Pioneers.
Now the question is going to be Hannah Applegate for the Lions, if they can nearly completely salvage it. Not a total salvage, but as close as they can get to salvaging it. We'll see about the score coming from Hannah Moon as that will come across soon.
Really nice front full to front layout technique. She had her legs right by her side on that front full. Typically you see your arms bent and upward when you twist.
Berklich tying for second highest score on the floor as she has been gifted a 9.85. And Texas women's now 39.2 flat on the floor.
On the right, Emma Lavelle, this is a great event for her. And unfortunately, comes off on that layout step out. I can't quite tell what happened. She seemed to be in line with the beam, but I think she just was not quite prepared for that landing. But obviously it is only 10 centimeters, which is about 4 inches. So at any point, any small adjustment, you can be off the beam. interesting, the switch side with an extra quarter turn. And she does her full pirouette in the side position. Very, very unique. That's what I love so much about the Centenary team, is they do things that athletes nowhere in the NCAA are doing. Big routine for the Lions and for Applegate herself. This could be a championship winning routine. Mounts the high bar. We'll see a triple combination, clear hip to Ginger. To Bale, a little close on that. I think she caught that Ginger a little with more bent arms than she expected. But these last three athletes have gone super aggressive on their handstands like for their dismount. And that's exactly what you want to see. Just a small step forward. Not quite her best.
Hannah Moon with that 9-8. We'll see what Applegate's score comes across as. And if you are the Lions, you got to hope it's somewhere around that same category of Hannah Moon. Right now, it could be the complete decider of the conference champion right now. On the other side, Texas women certainly putting up a fight themselves. As on the floor now, a 9-9 for Daisy Woodring. She is now tied for that title. And on the floor.
On the top of the broadcast, I said that Hernandez and Woodring have the program record on floor, and it isn't for no reason. A little low on that double pike, but saves it. But this has been such a strong rotation for the Pioneers. Another 49. Consistency is going to win this meet, and they have been consistently so strong.
Woodring does hold the season high, and Hernandez right with her. They both have had 9-9-5s this season. We'll see how Hernandez does. Nine, 8-2-5 is the score for Applegate. We'll see how much that affects the eventual end of this matchup, but Texas women's with a nearly perfect so far rotation on the floor. 49.1, impressive number from the Pioneers. On the beam right now, Amy Foray looking to round off the beam for Centenary. Labatt with a 9.875.
That puts her in lead on vault. And again, very interesting. Illinois State only with a 49.1. We've seen them go higher on vault, but that does, for right now, match Texas women's on floor. Very, very interesting to see if Texas women's can hold their position and maybe even overtake the Redbirds.
They'll await the score from Sophie Hernandez, and if she does get higher than that 9.75, they'll be able to jump up just a little bit more than Illinois State by just a smidgen in terms of this rotation. But still, impressive number from Illinois State in the vault, that 49.1. Two 9.8s. With the two 9.85s and the 9.875, then 9.750, 9.775. You can drop a 9.752. That is exactly what you want. Lindenwood just with those two tough ones. And, you know, you can afford one possible dud or accidental fall rotation, but when you get two of them, it's difficult to come back from that. Speaking of coming back, we'll be right back after a break. When we do come back, we're going to have some more highlights, give you some scores, and take a look at how it's shaping up after this third rotation. This is the MIC Championships on ESPN+. Plus.
We are through three rotations now here at the MIC Conference Championships, as we'll be able to take a look at some of the highlights from the third rotation. And it started off with a season high on the vault for Illinois State, and it was an impressive one as well.
A little hiccup on the bars for the Lions with some really nice performances from Maya Krause and Hannah Applegate.
Angelica Labatt took the vault lead with a 9.875. We saw two lead changes in terms of, or make that three in terms of a leader on the, right now currently on the beam it is still Angelica Labatt. On the floor though, J-Mac and Daisy Woodring are tied for that top score, the 9.9 for both of them. On the bars, Nia Krause took the lead. Three Lindenwood scorers top the bars, but it was their fifth one that they had to continue to, that they could not drop because they had two tough score lines. That one being a 9.325 from Reese Beekle. But Krause, Applegate, and Moon with three impressive routines for themselves. A 9.875, that is what leads the field right now in terms of the bars. Nia Krause, who had a nearly perfect routine. Team scores as it stands after that third rotation. Illinois State on top. They will try to defend their championship, but they have the bye rotation now, and they'll get an opportunity to see Texas Women's. Texas Women's will have their last rotation. They'll have the fifth rotation bye. So Illinois State will get a chance to, pending if they do all the math while they watch on, they will be able to know how much they need to defend their championship, pending the, of course, other scores coming from Southeast Missouri State and Lindenwood, who also sit at that 97 point mark, just 0.25 separating those two. We'll see how those stands as the rotation's getting ready. SEMO will be on the bars, Lindenwood on the beam, Centenary on the floor, and on vault will be Texas Women's. And as the score sits right now, Illinois State in front, 147.575. Texas Women's behind them, 146.975. SEMO 97.550. Lindenwood 97.525. Centenary 92.600. As we are getting ready on the bar, or on the bars, yes. Taylor Engel kicking us off. Cammie Zarlengo on the vault. Anna Moon will start off on the beam once we get the start time for those, or the good to go for those, I should say. And then on the floor, Kendall Huff for Centenary. First routine. Ooh, a jump outside of the lines.
Yeah, there's no automatic deductions for stepping outside of those black lines. However, it gives the judges a better view of how in line you are and you land from the vault.
Not an out-of-bounds marker. Kind of the same thing with the floor, but it does give a better idea in terms of staying in line. So no automatic deduction, as you said. But on the bars right now.
Nice. This sound from Engel, just that step backward. I like her swing. She's a very slow swing and takes her time.
As you see the scores from our last rotation, we got some of the final scores updated now. And this is a flow routine that is certainly beloved by all MIC conference teams. Kendall Huff, the Devil Went Down to Georgia. Foresee Centenary coming out of Shreveport, Louisiana. Kendall Huff from Rivera, Texas. So I gotta wonder what the connection might be, or if it's just a really nice song that she likes.
Cannon Moon mounts the beam. Very important to get the Lions back online. Gorgeous back handspring layout step out. I love her technique. She is so flexible, and it's so gorgeous to watch her do any flip.
Beam has not been the Lions' best. 50th in the nation on the beam. Their best is actually their bars, which are 35th, but clearly not the best that they've had tonight, that bar routine for them. Now, Hannah Moon does hold the season high along with Nia Krause with 9.9s on the beam.
Nice finish for Kendall Huff. You see Hannah Moon prepares for her gainer full dismount. Really nice finish there. Just some small little adjustments throughout the routine, but should definitely be a strong leadoff. You typically see Gigi Griswold in the leadoff spot for the Lions, but Hannah Moon has done a fabulous job today. Really gorgeous vault there. No twisting off of the back handspring. Similar technique we saw from Jaylee Jones. And a perfectly stuck dismount from Ava Johnston. Our first look at her today for the SEMO Redhawks. It's important that the Texas Women's Pioneers have a strong vault rotation, as they will not compete in the fifth rotation. This is their final event. Want to finish very strong and set a high bar for the Redbirds, who are on a bye right now.
Amy Zarlengo with a 9.7 to kick off on the vault for Texas Women's. Taylor Engel with a 9.7 for SEMO on the bars. Illinois State getting their break.
See Claire Flores getting a chat from head coach Meg Crowley.
There's only one gymnast for Illinois State looking for that all-around title, that being Labatt. And she has had three impressive scores, 9.875 on the vault, 9.925 on the beam, and a 9.825 on the floor. She leads in the vault and the beam. She might take home three titles tonight.
On the right side of your screen, this is Jaden Kuseth. Nice, just a small check on that triple series. Our first look at the freshman class from Lindenwood. Jaden hasn't been in the beam lineup as often, but so far this routine has been really strong, and she's put up some strong numbers for them so far this season. Really nice there on that switch half.
See Hannah Moon, 9.85. Good start for the Lions.
And a stuck dismount. Huge for the Lions. They did have to count that miss from Bickle in the bars rotation, so it's really important they can continue this high energy on beam. Sophia Isbell, first look at her. Little short there on that step forward. Unfortunately, this score won't be as high as she wants. The judges really don't like when you take steps towards the vault. Usually incurs a larger deduction.
And still that lone score for Centenary, a 9.6 on the floor.
Here's Kaylin Hamilton with that pecked mount in the stretch position. Small leg bend into that ginger bail, that same triple combination we saw from Hannah Applegate.
9.775 for Ava Johnston. And a 9.725 for Emma Berklich. 9.725.
Really nice dismount there, just that small step to the side. Showing some really strong difficulty though.
some groovy jams here at Highland Arena. As Jaylee Jones gets on the beam for the Lions. They're grooving out here, here in St. Charles.
Jaylee gets ready to mount. I got to talk to her after the last home meet here on senior night, and she said that she changed her beam routine 2 days before that meet. So thankfully she's had a little bit more time to get used to this new composition.
Looks like a 9.75 for Kusuth.
Here's that new combination. Cat leap into the switch half into the beat jump with lots of bonus. That's how she can get her 10-0 start value. Isabel Plaza on the right on floor exercise for the ladies. Barani into the back 1.5. Such a unique combination. I believe she's the only gymnast in the country to do that. Really dynamic vault there, Steely King. Similar technique that we saw from Emma. Just the punch front full from Isabel Plaza. Must be part, you have to have at least two elements C or higher. Ooh. And does not quite get that leap series. This could be a big issue. You have to have a connection of two dance elements. Would not be surprised if this caused a judges conference to see if they credit that as a lead combination.
So Kusis does get that 9.875. 9.65 for Flores as Lydia Webb steps up for SEMO.
Lydia Webb is fabulous on this event. Look at her gorgeous line. Sets up for a sky-high jigger and just catches way too close and does not get a good grip. It looks like when she let go, she went straight up instead of going out away from the bar. You want to catch these release moves with straight arms, so you have to let go at the right time, and she just didn't time that right.
Webb competing for that all-around title as well.
Here's Madison Rush, the reigning MIC beam champion. There was a five-way tie last year. Such a cool mount there that she does. She's a beam specialist for the Lions. They're really looking to her to get a nice number for them. Signature combo, hitch kick into the pike side semi. Gorgeous full turn. Very confident work so far from Rush. This is the big test. Back handspring, layout step out. Dead on.
Wow. She didn't even need to correct herself there. That was perfect placement. And as you said, that beam is only 4 inches in terms of width. That is not an easy spot to, doesn't matter who you are, that has got to be.
Cut a Ray White quick, but she did switch leap and actually changed her routine, switch leap to split jump into the staggering jump. This is the gainer full. Perfect landing. The best routine I've ever seen her do.
Wow. We might see another jump up in the bar in the beam. Right now, the beam lead is Labatt with a 9.925, but I would not be surprised if that one might tie it.
Huge ball from Daisy Woodring. Just that small scoot backward. she could definitely take the title with that.
9-7-5 for Steely King. The vault lead right now is Labatt with that 9-8-7-5. We'll see if that is what does it. Woodring.
Sophie Schmitz for Centenary. Centenary yet to break out of the 9-6s.
Jaylee Jones has a 9-8, and that's certainly a score you'd want to drop as a 9-8. And even then, 9-8's not even that bad of a score. So it's a good start. Jaylee Jones getting that one. We'll see what Rush is given.
I see some 9-9s from some of the judges. Again, there's four judges at this meet, so they will drop the high, drop the low, and then average the two median scores.
9-9, 9-8-5.
Looks like one judge posted a 9-4.
Interesting. Certainly interesting.
Now, I believe that she would be out of range, so I'm surprised there hasn't been a conference. Maybe the score flasher put the wrong number. Strong finish for Sophie Schmitz there on the floor with the double twist.
So a 9-8-5 for Rush, officially, it looks like.
Janelle Lopez on the bars. We saw her on vault. Very perfect handstand on that half turn. And catches the Jaeger this time. Oh, and really short there. But hits the handstand on that bail. And short there again. She could get up to 0.2 total for those handstands.
Great dismount, though.
Yeah. Applegate over on the beam.
Applegate, one of the all-around contenders for the Lions.
Only an 8-5-2 for Lydia Webb. Definitely the score to drop. Looks like the Lions have really found their footing again on those layout step-outs. Ooh! I just jinxed it. Another layout step out, but with the large balance check, thankfully the rest of the lineup has been so strong with a low of only a 9-8 from Jaylee Jones.
Madison Rush with that 9-8-5. That's kind of surprised to see a 9-8-5 there. Certainly expected something a little higher, because now she sits underneath Kosas' run. Great nice dismount. And I don't think we will see a Lions score on the beam go under that 9-8 mark. With, pending the broadcaster's jinx, of course.
Caitlin Hoyland, anchor for Texas Women's. And a great ball, just to hop in place. Perfectly straight throughout. Newcomer of the year for the MIC. She came from Oregon State and has just done so much fabulous work for the Pioneers. So glad that she's in the MIC now. Olivia Williams, Kristen Snare, here's some big tumbling. Double back.
Centenary looking to drop that 9-3-7-5 from Plaza. We await Applegate's score as Naya Kraus will finish off the Lions on the beam. Hoyland season high on the vault, 9-8-7-5. Woodring had a 9-9-5 earlier this season. Just shy of that one, 9-8-5. So an impressive showing on the vault for the Pioneers as Naya Kraus is jumping up on the beam.
Strong finish strong finish for Olivia Williams. Here is SEMO's anchor, Sydney Crouch. Nia Kraus defending her beam title.
Crouch is, while the anchor, only a season high of 9.775 on the bars.
Really difficult dismount there. The underswing to front pike half.
That might be a season high right there. What a dismount.
And a great dismount from Nia as well.
She has probably been the biggest in terms of emotion alongside her scores on this Lion side this season. She has been the most enthusiastic gymnast on this Lion side. And she just continues to show it.
A 9.875 comes in for Caitlin Hoyland. That, I believe, ties her for the lead on vault. She's now tied with Labatt.
Oh, a three-way tie. Two-way tie, yes. Tied with Labatt.
And here is, I've been so excited to see this routine. This is Lacey Wedge. Shh, everyone be quiet.
Kraus, let's see. It looks like some high scores from the judges.
Here's this double Arabian from Lacey Wedge. Oh, no.
We will see what Nia Kraus has been gifted. 9-9 for Nia Kraus.
And a 10 from Wedge Judge.
She did get a 10 from one of the four, so that is exactly what you want. A 9-9 for Nia Kraus. Applegate had a 9-6, so they'll drop Applegate's score, but that is exactly what you needed if you are the Lions. A 9-9 from Nia Kraus as Lacey Wedge wraps us up here in this fourth rotation.
You can tell she's a little deflated there. Had to sit down that double Arabian. Such a difficult pass.
So now we will head on to our media timeout in between as we get ready for our final rotation of the night. All right, we will take our break. When we come back, more MIC championships here on ESPN+. Welcome back. Rotation number four just ending as it has been continuing to be a very, very close MIC championships. And it's going to come down to this final rotation. We take a look at some of the highlights from rotation number four. And it was highlighted indeed. Nia Kraus with a 9-9 on the beam for the Lions, on the floor for Centenary. The top scorer, 9.725 from Olivia Williams. On the bar side for Southeast Missouri State. Highest side, 9.85 for Madison Green. This final rotation will determine who is the MIC championships. As a couple of good scores, a couple of tough scores for the Lions, along with for SEMO on the bars. But a great showing on the vault for Texas women's. They have a 1.95, but all they can do is watch as they had the final bye in the rotation.
195-875 is what they sit at. That is their final score. We will see if Illinois State, Lindenwood, or Southeast Missouri State can overtake that mark. It will all come down to this final rotation. We'll take one more break. When we come back, a champion will be crowned. This is the MIC Championships on ESPN+. Welcome back to Highland Arena, the MIC Championship, as we are getting ready to crown a champion. Fifth and final rotation here at Highland Arena. Jacob Sonic alongside Caleb Deckard. If you're just joining us, Texas Women's right now, they have the bye here in this rotation. All they can do is watch, as they right now have still an impressive 195-875. And it's going to take a lot just to top them. Illinois State's in at 147-575, 146-800 for Lindenwood. SEMO, 146-050. Centenary sitting at that 141 mark, 0.25 as well. But it's going to take near perfection from both Lindenwood, Illinois State, and SEMO to try and top Texas Women's. Unfortunately, Centenary just out of the running. As we will take a look at our final rotation, Lindenwood on the floor, Centenary on the vault. On the beam, Southeast Missouri State. And over on the bars will be Illinois State. But the real question will be, Illinois State has had a lot of struggles this season. Not their best spot, the bars. Lindenwood on the floor, not their best, not their worst. But they have had some success. They're going to need at least a 9-1 to just take Texas Women's. So it's going to come down to this final rotation, the biggest eyes on Lindenwood and Illinois State. But SEMO still in the running as well, right behind them. Where they will also need a nearly perfect beam. 49 points, if I'm doing my math right, 49.725 to tie Texas Women's. So they're going to need near, and by definition, near perfection in order to just tie Texas Women's.
And if Lindenwood Lions want to come out on top, they're going to need mistakes from Illinois on bars.
He just flashed the scores on the screen here at Highland Arena. I don't know if many gymnasts even wanted to look at the scores right now. They know what's at stake. Illinois State trying to defend their championship. Texas Women's trying to win their first since 2021.
Maya Robinson has mounted an even bars. She did a toe on to Maloney and goes back down with the bail, hits that position nicely. Lots of combinations in this routine. And this is the most important job of the team. Another really difficult dismount, just a step backward, but this leadoff is so important. Just how she leaded them off so nicely on beam. They needed a strong hit to start on bars. That's what's really going to set the tone for them so they can get this MIC championship.
Southeast Missouri State, trying to win their first championship since 2014. After that, seven straight MIC championships for Lindenwood. They're trying to win their first since 2021. And then that was snapped by Texas Women's in 2022. They have bested that championship score by 0.1. They won the 2022 MICs with a 195-750. So they've already bested that. It's just a matter of if Illinois State, their final one on the bars, can they beat their winning score of 196-375, possibly even win or beat the overall record. That one set by University of Illinois Chicago way back in the day of 2003.
196.575. That is the championship record for a team. As Simone Evans, first time we've seen her tonight for the Lions, on the floor.
This athlete has an amazing story. She had an Achilles injury last year and missed the majority of the season, but so glad to see her back, and she's done a fabulous job leading them off on floor this whole season.
Getting ready on the vault, Amy Ferrey.
Last pass for Evans. Right off that handspring, double back. Perfect landing. You can tell she's fighting in every single move. You can see all of the work and all of the effort going into today. This is so important for this whole team.
Up next on the bars, Carly Hawksworth for Illinois State as we await the score lines coming in.
Carly had a fall last time she was here at Lindenwood on this element, the Ginger. Nice combination there, just a small leg separation, but she has to stay on. That's exactly what she needs. Perfect handstand there. Oh, no! Knees down on the double layout.
The break Lindenwood needed right there. But they're going to need one more of those. They're going to need one more. Illinois State cannot afford one more fall. They'll be able to drop that one. It's going to be the question of if they have another.
The pressure is on for these next four athletes for the Redbirds.
First score coming across, Maya Robinson, 9-7 on the bars for Illinois State. Good start on the bars. McClung with a 9-3 on the vault.
Here's Trinity Cathy. We haven't seen her every single week on floor. She's taken some breaks, but we're so glad to see her back. This routine is packed full of difficulty.
Cathy also competed on the vault with a 9-8.
First pass, front layout, Rudy. Great landing. Really important she got that step backwards. The lunge needs to go the direction away from your landing.
Amy Foray up next on the vault.
Nice leaps there. She made sure she got that turnaround.
That slight hop. Otherwise, good performance coming from Foray.
Night 8 comes through for Evans. A strong leadoff.
9-8 for the Lions. It's what they need, but they're going to need a little bit more as well. 156.6, 157.25, 195.875.
Nice save there. She's a little off on that double back. Another hit in the books for the Lions. One step closer to the MIC title.
It's going to be tight already. Texas women's putting up an impressive scoreline. Illinois State now.
Reese Gala,
38 points behind.
Freshman from Canada. Huge job here. She has to stay on.
And that is going to be on the minds of every single gymnast now for Illinois State. A fall could just cost them back-to-back titles.
Difficult toe full to double back. Just a few scoots forward. A nice routine. She has gorgeous toe point. So glad she got to showcase that through a gorgeous routine. But not only do the Redbirds have to stay on the bars, they have to score big. The scores like this 9-7 from Robinson are not going to cut it.
Jordan Napolitano on the beam now as the Redhawks know that they're also still in contention. But they will need more perfection than Illinois State does, and even more perfection than Lindenwood. Now, Hannah Applegate, one of the contenders for the all-around title.
Sophie Schmitz sticks that layout. Yurchenko only has a 9-7 start, but that was a great landing. Applegate is in the all-around today. But floor is the event that she usually sits out, but today she gets the call.
Gayla Griswold holds the season high for the Lions on the floor, 9-9-7-5. She is not listed on the floor for the Lions today. Jaylee Jones right behind her, 9-9-2-5. Nia Krause with a 9-9.
Important leap here to go, Jen.
Applegate's season high, 9-8-2-5-0. She will have to meet that mark today.
Leap series here. Nice shapes on those jumps. Just a double back left. Hopefully she has enough gas in the tank. Ooh, a little short on that double pike. That'll be quite the deduction. It could go as high as 2/10 for that really low landing and step forward. Definitely going to be the score that the Lions need to drop. Madison Kipp mounting the bars.
Nothing yet so far besides the opening scores.
Gorgeous Jaeger caught with perfectly straight arms.
Illinois State knows. No! Oh, no! That is exactly what they could not afford.
She stays on the bar, but that will count as a fall. They will take a half-point deduction. She fought so hard to stay on.
So they will have to count a fall.
And another fall from Madison Green. Still a smile on Kip's face, though.
That might be the determining factor, as we will see how far that one drops from Kip. Kip had a, and the one thing that does stink, she had her season high on the vault earlier today, as now Nia Krause, we got a 9-9 on the beam, competing for that all around. Not compete for the all-around, was not on the vault, but trying to get a second 9-9 score line.
1.5 punch layout, very important.
Lions fans now with an even harder heart rate, even higher heart rate, as they know what's at stake now. No Lion can afford a mistake as we still await those score lines. About four in for each one as Huff steps up on the vault for Centenary. Ooh.
Tuck full Yurchenko, really low landing. Big final pass for Nia. Needs to go big on this. The meat is on the line. Great landing.
How it stands now, it is a great possibility that Texas women's could possibly take home the championship as well. But for Lindenwood, is Nia Krause again, a nice, incredible performance on the floor. And always showing that incredible emotion, and that is the best part of these championships. Allie Kuhn with a 9-7 on the beam, so a good start. We'll see how that beam score does turn out. They did have that one tough fall.
Sarah Wabby in the number 5 spot. She was second last year on bars at the MICs. Needs to help this team finish strong even after counting a fall.
She's going to need something over 9-7 at least.
Perfect giant full into that dismount. Just a step backwards. Really went for it. She knows she has to go for it.
Looking like some high scores coming for Nia Kraus. We'll see what the official tally is. Looking like a 9.875.
She's had a great day so far. Nothing lower than a 9.875.
So Trinity Caffey gets a 9.8, and that's exactly what the Lions want. If you can drop one of those 9.8s, that's exactly what they want. Applegate with a 9.675. So that's definitely the one they'll look to drop. And see what Krause's is gifted.
Coming after that miss on bar, she needs to bring it back if they want to take this title.
And that will be a fantastic storyline if she can.
Big test here, double front full.
Just went to the side, but she definitely saved that. Kind of a, that was one of the smoothest saves I think we've seen, to be honest. That was nice. She went right into that spin. And hopefully the judges didn't notice.
She's performing perfectly precise there on that polpa.
See the scores coming in on for Centenary. 9.525, 9.450. McClung with that 9.3, Huff with a 9.450 as well. Foray with a 9.525.
Big pass here, 1.5 front full. Needs to keep this in. Nice landing.
And Highland responds accordingly to a great performance from Reese Beekel, as she might have made up for that mistake.
So amazing to see her. She was a transfer from Mizzou. I'm so glad we had the chance to see her at the MIC Championships. That was a beautiful routine. Finishing out, Angelica Labatz all around day, another fall.
Oh no, it is falling apart for Illinois State. Labatt with a fall. And not only does that hurt the team, that hurts her all around. And that now is the worst situation you could get for the Redbirds. As now instead of just counting one fall, they have to count two.
Really unfortunate. This is the same thing that happened last year. On the last rotation, she had a fall and lost the all-around title.
We see now the scores coming in, and they have to count the 9-1. That is going to be the tough one, counting a 9-1 compared to Lindenwood, where they had to count just a 9-3-2-5. Here we get some more scores coming in. Nia Kraus, 9-8-7-5. Grala with a 9.775, Kip with that 9.075, and Hawksworth with a 9.1. That is the one they'll have to count. It is coming down to the wire. Lindenwood 10 points away from overtaking Texas Women's. It's going to come down to the scores of Beekel and Jaylee Jones.
A 9.9 just came in from Reese. And Elabot redoes that combination. Very, very risky, but she's a gamer. Her coaches said she loves to win. She doesn't just like to compete. She wants to win. So I know she's disappointed in herself.
So a 9-9. Lindenwood now has to get... All Lindenwood has to do is drop Applegate's score.
Jaylee Jones needs at least a 9-7 to overtake Texas Women's. She has a season high of 9.925.
If Jaylee Jones gets the 9.7, the Lions will be MIC champions. As Illinois State, having to count two falls, will not be able to take Texas women's. Great landing. We will see what the final score is coming across. SEMO will probably just not have enough after they had a couple of tough routines on the beam.
We've got to dial in on these landings. Nice there. She can be so consistent. But this is when it really counts.
Comes down to Jaylee Jones. As the final scores will come in for Illinois State. Along with Southeast Missouri State, all Illinois State can do is sit back and watch. And Jaylee Jones has to get a 9-7 to overtake Texas women's. They sit 0.25 behind. Illinois State's final score is coming across. Sarah Wabi, 9-7-5. We'll see what Labatt is. They sit 1 point behind Lindenwood. Jaylee Jones, great. They will have to count that 9-1. We will see what Labatt scores and if it's enough. And Jaylee Jones with a great end. Will it be enough? If they can drop Applegate's score, they might have just won the MICs. We have to wait for Labatt's score as well. Scoring still going on the bar side. SEMO scores coming across 9-7, 9-7, a 9-0, and an 8-5-2-5. So SEMO will unfortunately not be able to get a hand in or no. See what they give Webb.
A pair of 9-8-5s from a couple judges.
We got a 9-9 on the other side as well.
Pretty fair to say.
9-9. As well. 9-9, final score for Jaylee Jones.
The MIC title is Lindenwood.
LU, the Lindenwood Lions on home field, home court, home mat, whatever it may be, at home, have claimed the MIC championship. Jaylee Jones with the 9-9. She drops Hannah Applegate's score. And pending the official scoring, but as it stands right now, the Lindenwood Lions have won the Midwest Independent Conference. They still stand on top of Illinois State, and there it is. Officially conference champions, the Lindenwood Lions, 196-075, the final score. We await the final performance from Taylor Engel to wrap up the rotation. Lydia Webb ended with a 9-7-5-0. Will not be enough for SEMO to fully get back in it. Or Lydia Webb still waiting that beam score from Lydia Webb. You'll see. 9-2-2-5, so will not be able to get back in it unless they can officially drop something significant, but they sit down 3 points, so don't know if that will officially happen.
Nice finish for Taylor Engel on the beam. She's still in the race for the all-around title. Right now, Jaylee Jones has the lead.
So that does it. Rotation four. The Lions, as it is, MIC champions 2024. We will take one final break. When we come back, a champion officially crowned. 2024, the Lindenwood Lions. We'll be right back. Awards and final champions. This is the MIC Championships on ESPN+. We are through all five rotations and the scores are officially in. Lindenwood, MIC Champions 2024. They win it at home in front of an amazing crowd here at Highland Arena. Texas women's taking second place. Illinois State, the defending champs, no longer defending. 195.1. SEMO 194.275. Centenary 188.550. We will get to our individual winners and officially grant the champion. And what a match it was. Jacob Sonic alongside Caleb Deckard. And Caleb, this was an incredible championship this afternoon. Came down to the wire, and all it took was a couple of unlucky falls from Illinois State. Lindenwood taking home the championship, and I mean, this whole entire season from all of these teams have accumulated to an incredible finish here at the conference champions. And Caleb, give me your final thoughts from this afternoon.
This was such a crazy meet. Came down to the final rotation, some of the final routines. Some really great performances from the Lions and the Pioneers and the Redbirds as well. The fact that Lindenwood came back after that fall on bars was incredible, but also Texas women's held their own throughout this entire meet. They should be so, so proud of themselves.
Texas women's themselves, they had a relatively rough season. They put up some great scores, but were unable to get really just a handful of wins of their own. They finished off 5-20 coming into this afternoon, but they do get second place, and it was well-deserved. Nearly took home a championship, but Lindenwood with a nearly perfect and incredible floor routine, and that is what brought them home a championship. And it was all Beekle who had that first fall and wasn't the lowest score, but they had to count her fall. And she comes back, gets a 9-9 on the final routine to seal the championship, as they will crown our individual champions. Don't want to spoil anything yet. We'll get to those in a second. But an incredible afternoon, an incredible ending to the MIC season, as Lindenwood taking home conference championship number 8. Their second time hosting, 8th championship. First time winning it since 2021 as they dethrone Illinois State. Texas women still looking for their first win since 2022.
Still a big deal. They did jump up from 4th place last year, so a really big deal for them to be this close to the win.
And especially since they did come into this afternoon with only 5 wins. And this is probably the most exciting part of it. Get the moment while all the judges get all the final official scoring, they get all the announcements ready, and they get a chance to dance it up with along with the fans and share some camaraderie with the opposing teams as well, as arguably my favorite artist, Noah Kahan, blasting over the speakers. Not to the typical stadium music one might pick, but, you know, I love blasting Stixies into my car, I'll tell you what. Well, you see the flashlights out, some dancing on the floor, and the Lions, 8-time champions. We'll take one final break, and we will come back, crown our champions, and wrap it up for this MIC Conference Championship. One more break, so don't go away. This is the MIC Championship on ESPN+.
NIC champion will be crowned. Officially, Lindenwood, the team champions, a total 196.075. Not the conference championship record for a team score, but certainly impressive nevertheless as they take home their eighth championship all time. Jacob Sonic, Caleb Deckard, and Caleb, this has been an incredible afternoon. I mean, you got to hand it to all five of these squads who came out, came down to that final rotation, and it was Lindenwood who came away with the win, an impressive showing, and I mean, what isn't there to say about this afternoon's incredible conference championship?
Yeah, this is such an amazing night, and this is a lot of these athletes' final time competing in their career, so glad they could go out on a bang and have such an exciting night for their final night as a gymnast.
And of course, Cotton Eye Joe ringing out a Highland Arena staple while we await the officials and our crowning of champions. And Azra looks, you know, some reluctant at first, but eventually just about everyone up on the floor dancing together, and that is the staple of college gymnastics. Well, I would say what these teams have up next, but this is the end of the season, so well, we'll suppose we'll see some in hopefully some of the regionals coming up. These teams will also be in the USA Gymnastics Collegiate National Championships. Is in Westchester, PA this year. Lindenwood has one of those under their belt as well. National championship at the USA Gymnastics Collegiate National Championships. Oh, not in the NCAA regionals still. That's still a best in the country. So these teams' final records, Lindenwood finishes off 9-4. Illinois State 15-12. I suppose if you top all those teams on in there, they are 17-13? I couldn't tell you. Either way, Lindenwood with the win. Texas Women's coming in second. Illinois State third. Southeast Missouri State fourth. Centenary in fifth. Texas Women's especially, that is a team that finished this year 5-20. Division II team as well. And they came here and nearly pulled off the shocker of the season. They last won the championship back in 2022, so it hasn't been long. They certainly have the experience and nearly came in and shocked everyone here in St. Charles. Old St. Chuck, as we are. Well, I thought that signified the beginning of our ceremonies, but nope, we're just getting into our next group dances. Now we'll take a look at some of the highlights from our fifth rotation and what clinched the conference championship. SEMO nearly also had themselves a close run for it. They were just a handful of decimal points behind Lindenwood. Illinois State, so close. Just had a couple of falls that just cost him. But some incredible stuff all around. Some great saves as well. And everybody in this arena, probably before that first fall, thought Illinois State was going to be walking away with that championship. But Lindenwood with the save and a couple of lucky breaks as well. So we will take one last break. Hopefully this is the last time I say one last break. When we come back, should be our ceremonies to wrap up these MIC championships. Thank you once again for joining us here. We'll take one final break. This is the MIC championships on ESPN+. Well, if you're interested, we are doing the twist right now. If you would like to join in at home, I certainly am up here twisting my buns off currently as we await for our official scores. Once again, your MIC champions 2024, the Lindenwood Lions, their eighth conference championship all time, and just their second time hosting the conference championships as well. Oh, nearly got it. As we await the official scoring.
SEMO, Anna Speller. final group of seniors from Texas Women's University, Maddie Gousset, Steely King, Daisy Woodring, Emily Six, and Caitlin Hoyland. Let's hear it for our Texas Women's seniors. Now let's have another hand for all of our seniors. All right, before we get into the still finalizing some scores, before we do, we'd like to turn it over to Texas Women's Head Coach, Lisa Powerman.
At this time, could we ask all of the Lindenwood gymnasts and coaches to please gather out in the center of the floor? The coaches and gymnasts from the MIC would like to present Lindenwood with this card and bouquet of flowers. The card is signed by every member of the MIC Gymnastics Conference. The roses represent our entire conference. There are 24 gold roses, one to represent each of your athletes and coaches. And there are roses representing the colors of the other four teams in our conference. Over the past 12 years, Lindenwood has brought an intense level of competition to our conference. They have competed with resilience and grit over the years and helped to shine a positive light on the MIC. The accolades of this program are impressive, and the camaraderie the Lions have brought to each competition over the last 12 years will definitely be missed. We wish them nothing but the best in their future endeavors, and know they will pursue their next chapters with dignity and grace. Thank you, Lions.
As they grab a group photo, we'd like to extend our own congratulations to all of the award winners this season for the MIC. A lot of awards going around and a lot of amazing winners and certainly deserving winners as well. And a great end of the season. Lindenwood, conference champs. Texas women's in the second place position. Illinois State, Southeast Missouri, and Centenary following on their respective spots as we are soon to get into our individual awards and crown our team champion. And one more time, a big congratulations to all the award winners and all of the seniors as well who have put in a lot of amazing work over the years for all five of these teams.
Ladies and gentlemen, I jumped the gun a little bit. There was a video that we shot yesterday of our seniors. Please turn your attention to the video board for reminiscent of some of our seniors.
They celebrate their seniors one more time, and over the past 4 years, it has been very, very tight. Three different champions in the past 4 years. Texas women's back in 2022, Illinois State last season, Lindenwood this year, and a few years ago, back in 2021, that was Lindenwood's most recent championship, but it has certainly been a while since. And before that, well, Lindenwood certainly had a run before the year of UIC. University of Illinois Chicago had that tie championship with Lindenwood in the midst of Lindenwood's seven straight MIC championships. And now before that happened, that was Southeast Missouri State, as they unfortunately not able to win their first championship since 2014, but they certainly put up a valiant fight, 194-275. I mean, they face the brunt of competition this year, facing off against some incredible teams. Kent State, they saw this Lion side a few times as well. University of Missouri, Denver, Iowa State, Nebraska, North Carolina, they have seen quite the fair share of competition, and that is all coming in tonight, and they just fell short. They certainly had a season to be proud of. All five of these teams, this amazing season to be proud of, as they will now move on to the next opponent, whether that is the NCAA Regionals, USA National Collegiate Regionals, or the USA Gymnastics National Championships team-wise. As they are showing some videos for each team celebrating their seniors. It's been an amazing season overall, for not just the seniors, but for freshmen, sophomores, juniors, across the board, across these amazing and sizable lineups. They have had incredible performances, incredible scores, and of course, the best of them all accumulating tonight. Well, hopefully, this is the hopeful one, this will actually be our final break. But you know what? We're just going to say let's take another break as we wait. Still a lot more ceremonies to go. And soon we will officially crown our champions. One more break here as this is the MIC Championship on ESPN+. While inside Highland Arena, we are still awaiting our crowning of champions as they take their time celebrating their seniors of all five squads and celebrating not just seniors, but all athletes as well. Again, congratulations to all the MIC award winners this season, and a big congratulations to all of the seniors this year who have put in countless years of work into their performances, into their skills, and also just being great teammates overall.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's time, though. Judges have tabulated. We've got our winners. If we can, turn your attention to the floor. Now, the way this is going to work is we've actually got you finish it.
So now we will have
you are second team all-conference. If you are first, second, or third place, get first team all conference. So we're going to start on
we will have our winners crowned, so we will turn it over to the PA.
Please make your way. There is a lot, so you're going to squeeze in a little bit. But make as best effort as you can. First up on vault, in sixth place with a score of 9.75, we have from Lindenwood, Hannah Applegate. From Illinois State, Alana Laster. From Southeast Missouri State, Taylor Inkley and Ivy King, and from Texas Women's, Steely King, all in sixth place with a score of 9.75. In fifth place with scores of 9.775, we have two athletes, Illinois State, Maya Robinson, and Lindenwood's, Allie Berkeley. In fourth place with a score of 9.80 from Lindenwood, Trinity Caffey. Now our next three are all first team. Our next three places are all first team all conference. From Lindenwood with a score of 9.825, Reese Beckley. Also from Lindenwood with a score of 9.825, Gigi Griswold. And in second place, We have four athletes, all score, tied with a score of 9.85 from Illinois State, Madison Kipp. Also from Illinois State, Jay Mack. From Southeast Missouri State, Madison Green. And from Texas Women's, Daisy Woodring. And we had a tie for the winner on vault for the 2024 MIC co-champions with scores of 9.875. From Illinois State, Angelica Labatt. And from Texas Women's, Caitlin Hoyland.
Texas Women's, Maddie Cousset and Steely King.
Lindenwood, Simone Evans, and Trinity Caffey. In fourth place, serving second team all-conference selections with scores of 9.825 from Illinois State, Sarah Lobby. From Illinois State, Alana Lester. Illinois State, Caitlin Donovan. And from Illinois State, Angelica Levant. And in third place, earning first team all MIC selections, three athletes with scores of 9.85. From Southeast Missouri State, Madison Green. And from Texas women, Sophie Hernandez and Emma Berkley. On floor in second place, one athlete with a 9.875 from Lindenwood, Nia Kraus. We have four athletes that tied with a 9.9 on floor. First up, Daisy Woodring from Texas Women's. Jay Mack from Illinois State. From Lindenwood, Jaylee Jones. And also from Lindenwood, Reese Beckley. Reese, Jaylee, Jay, and Daisy are your 2024 MIC champions on floor. Let's hear it for your first and second team all-conference selections. Next up, we have our all-around. We had six athletes. We'll recognize all six. We get four, five, and six. Second team, first up, 37.2 from SEMO, Lydia Webb. In fifth place with a 37.825 from Centenary, Sophie Schmitz. In fourth place with a 38.825 from Illinois State, Angelica Lamont. And in third place, earning first team all MIC with a score of 38.85 from Lindenwood, Hannah Applegate. And in second place with a score of 39.1 from SEMO, Taylor Engel. And we get a drum roll, please, our winner of the MIC All-Around with a score of 39.125 from Lindenwood, Jaylee Jones. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear for your All-Around All-Conference selection. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Illinois State. Next up in second place with a score of 195.875, Texas Women's University. And your 2024 MIC champions,
the score of 196.075, your Lindenwood.
Lindenwood, the 2024 MIC champions. And one last time on the vault, Angelica Labatt from Illinois State, the champion on the bars. Nia Krause from Lindenwood, the champion on the bars. On the beam, it was Labatt again. And on the floor, a four-way tie between Reese Beekel, Jaylee Jones, Jay Mack, and Daisy Woodring, and the all-around Jaylee Jones from Lindenwood. And one last time, your 2024 MIC Conference Champions, the Lindenwood Lions. An incredible season from all five teams, and the eventual champion, Lindenwood, coming out on top. And it all came down to that final rotation. What a season, and what a way to end it here in St. Charles. Lindenwood's eighth all-time conference championship and just their second time hosting. An incredible afternoon, and Caleb, final thoughts from you on this incredible, incredible afternoon and season as well.
There's just so many incredible stories, incredible moments from today. I'm so proud of all the athletes, and I really love this conference, and I love just how unique and just how special everything is, and I'm so glad that we could see all the talent we saw today.
Well, that will do it from us. So long from Highland Arena here in St. Charles, Missouri. Lindenwood Lions, your 2024 MIC Conference Champions. All games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN. For Caleb Deckard and our production crew, have a fantastic weekend.